Welcome, y'all, to the Blackhoof Saloon, a Wild West Exodus podcast. Mosey on up to the bar and get yourself a bottle of fire water or a glass of sarsaparilla and listen to some good old yarns about adventures of law dogs, outlaws, and weird creatures. So set a spell, water your ride or your rider, and get ready to tune up your posses. This is the Blackhoof Saloon.
Howdy, howdy, buckaroos, cowpokes, greenhorns, all you huckleberries, sidewinders, howdy, rustlers, all you saddle bums, bronco busters, cowpunchers, dudes and dudettes, bush rangers, howdy, howdy, all you ropers. And no, we're not talking about the Three's Company, but we're talking about all you card sharks out there. Welcome back to Blackhoof Saloon. This is Eric here, and I am here with Brian and Tom. And, hey guys, happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Yeah, that's all as far as I'm going with that.
Okay. I was expecting a yeehaw from you, Brian.
What's that?
I was expecting a
yeehaw.
Yeehaw!
So, yes, it is our one-year anniversary of the Blackhoof Saloon, and today we got a pretty big show for all you guys out there. So, some of the things we're going to be talking about today is we have a big contest reveal a little bit later in the show, as well as me and Brian got together with Stuart and talked a little bit about all stuff Wild West Exodus and new Lost World Exodus, as well as other news and we have just some other things that we wanted to chit-chat about. But before we get into that, how about we talk about our birthday episode and reflect a little bit about the year of recording Blackhoof Saloon. So it was just over a year ago that the three of us started talking about doing something like this. And let's see, what we kind of planned out like what we wanted to do with the show, and we actually did do one recording that never saw the light of day. It was kind of tough learning at first because, you know, all three of us never, you know, we didn't really know too much about the technology of recording. So, you know, we had to learn all that technical stuff. But
sure. Two of us still don't.
Well, you guys could get on Skype and talk to me. So, but no, I think progression over the year, I think we, all three of us, have improved a little bit. You know, we, even though we're sitting here yakking about stuff, we, all three of us, have learned something in the game. And I mean, it was one of the things that kind of made me want to do it. It's like, hey, maybe I'll learn something more about the game if I can talk about it, whether, you know, goofing around or actually trying to help other community members learn about some aspect in the game. What do you guys like about doing the show after a year?
Well, for me, this is my way of staying involved in the community. I find it very hard to find time to play games, just between work and family schedules and stuff. I kind of only get to play games really over the summer and then maybe for a month or so over the winter. So I have long droughts where I just can't play games. This is my favorite game out there, and it lets me keep up on what's going on, lets me keep up on how things work, you know, make sure that I actually still know how to play this game.
you know, you're not setting up that game against yourself yet and kicking your own ass?
Well, you know, you can only kick your own ass so many times. you know, so for me, that's the big
part
here, there.
Yeah, you can't find a really good opponent.
It's true. It's all true. So, you know, so for me, I think that's the most important part of it for me, is just to really kind of stay involved during those months where I can't get games in.
Yeah. Hey, you said your son was getting back into it too, right, Tom? A little bit?
He is, and he has a friend and his friend's dad who are thinking of picking it up.
Okay.
And they live only, you know, 5 minutes away, so I may actually be able to start getting some – can't get into a store, really, but I might be able to start getting some games in.
Yeah. You got terrain now. And,
yeah, have some terrain, and, you know, it's been a year making progress. I painted a model, you know, so everything's trending up.
How about you, Brian?
Okay, so I really enjoy just talking about Wild West Exodus. It doesn't really matter when, where, or how. So I really enjoy, one, getting to know both of you guys doing this podcast, getting to know some of the community members, because there's conversations going on outside the podcast based off of people listening to our show. I just really enjoy sharing the game and come up with new ways of getting information out to people. I do enjoy how we get to laugh.
Yeah, there's a lot of moments of laughing that I can't put in the show that listeners know this, that some of the times when we just lose it and I have to cut it or, you know, sometimes I can save it and
yeah, show up in the gag reel.
Yes, yeah, so... kind of going off of that. Sometimes what we do is we do have, you know, kind of loose scripted notes of some of the key points we want to talk about, whether it's, you know, a topic or one of our segments. But there's been many times where we get off the rails and we end up having outtakes. And some of those outtakes do make it in the show. I started doing something that a lot of you guys probably haven't found yet. But after the end credits, after the end music, I put in a bunch of those outtakes of us just goofing or losing it. And I think more times than not, it's because of Tom. Tom usually says something that triggers me and Brian's funny bone that we just lose it. We lose track of what the hell we were talking about. It's just, we can't stop laughing.
Yeah, I aim to take the show off the rails. everybody needs to have a purpose. Brian knows the game real good. You know, Eric knows how to all the technical stuff. I'm just here to make a mess of things.
Yeah, you make it fun for me when I try to keep us on the rail and keep moving. Otherwise, we'll have a 5-hour show.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me started with Bush Rangers.
Well, I'll have to say that one of my favorite things about the show, thinking about it and hearing like what you guys had to say, is I love connecting more with the community. One of the things that I wanted to do with the show was to kind of help bring other players together with the show and create a community. And yeah, that was one, like you said, Brian, I love talking with some of the people I never knew before we started doing this. Yeah, I got to meet a lot of people on, you know, the Dark Council, just by, you know, you start chatting and commenting and stuff like that. But there's been, especially of late, there's been a lot of new players coming into the game and fairly new players from, you know, a while back that they started listening to the show and commenting on the show. And then, you know, we're starting to talk to them. And I, you know, I got the lucky chance to meet a lot of them at AdeptiCon. So that, I think that's one of my favorite things about doing the show after a year.
Right. Well, now, you know, right along with that, with you saying that, I thought one of the kind of funniest, coolest things that happened was when we were at PAX East. Someone approached me and they're like, "Oh, hey, Tom, how you doing?" I don't even remember who it was who introduced themselves. I mean, we had our shirts on and stuff. I was like, "Oh, hey, how you doing? You know, pleased to meet you or whatever." And he was like, "Yeah, I knew who you were. I recognized your voice."
Yeah,
I was like, all right, that's weird.
It kind of does. The first time that happens, it does blow you away because, you know, we don't consider, we just think of ourselves as players that are, you know, lucky enough to kind of actually record our rambling, and then you guys are, you know, listening to it and enjoying it, and we do appreciate you guys doing that and giving us feedback. Because we're still just blown away by some of the response of us doing, the podcast. So how about this, guys? So what do you guys feel that you gained from doing the show after a year? Is there anything different that you can take from doing this, talking about this stuff for a year?
I know how to play the game now.
That's because we make you do homework.
Sure, but I know how to play the game now.
Brian, how about you, got anything that you think that you gained from doing the show?
I think Tom's right. I mean, even though I probably, between you and I, Eric, have had probably more games than Tom, we're learning too.
Yeah.
You know, especially searching for for a new topic and, hey, let's dive into this. I don't know how many times that we've discussed things and people outside, like listeners, will say, hey, what about this? And we'll have to dive right back in it to either confirm that person's right or confirm that, no, we have it right. And then share it again, saying, no, this is actually what we meant. Occasionally we do say things, misspeak or get it wrong, or they give us new insights to how things could work in the game. And I enjoy that. I enjoy learning both sides of the game from all the different angles. I really enjoyed talking about the scenarios a little more.
Oh, God. Yeah, that episode, I think, you know, it's like we knew of the Badlands, okay? And, yeah, they're cool. But until we deep dived into it, we didn't realize how cool they were. And that was really neat. So, yeah, I agree with you. The show has forced us to look at the game in a little bit different way, and it kind of reinforces not only just the rules but how to play the game. I think that just like the last couple months, my thought processes for posse building has changed. I'm starting to look at, you know, certain characters in the game's abilities and, you know, thinking about, okay, how can I benefit from this for the most? You know, I'm looking at different factions now because I hear other people talking about them more. So, like, factions that I'm just like, yeah, I don't want no part of that. Well, you know, after AdeptiCon, I came home with factions that I didn't think I was going to ever play. So, I can't say that I feel dirty anymore. But, yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the big things that, you know, along those lines that I really picked up on, and because somewhere along the line, I remember someone posting either in the Discord or on the Facebook group, you know, why would you ever take, you know, this unit or that unit, or why would you use this weapon when you have that weapon? And it came down to, it's like, well, because you get a status effect. And you know, especially when we went through the episode of all the effects and how they change. So, like, if you stun someone, now the next attack becomes lethal. You know, things like that. You know, under certain situations, it really brings a whole another level of strategy where, yeah, you're not always just trying to do the most damage you can do. There's much deeper strategy to it than that.
Definitely, definitely. So yeah, like Brian said, we're still learning too. we're you know, taking little bits and pieces of listeners and other community members, and I think that's, you know, very beneficial, you know, for everybody, because then we're kind of bringing it out to the, you know, in the open with recording, talking about it. So how about this? Let's switch gears a little bit, since we're reflecting of the podcast for the last year. And I want to talk to you guys about favorite moments. So some of these moments in the last 11 episodes, whether it was a highlight or, you know, just some fun audio of us, you know, screwing around. So outside of outtakes, what is some of your guys' favorite moments that you can think of off the top of your head from our past episodes? Go ahead, Tom. You got one?
Well, I would share mine with you, but I'm feeling a little recalcitrant right now.
Brian was trying to hold back a laugh there, but yeah. So what I think what we're going to do is, so I'm going to go back in some of our past episodes, and I'm going to grab that little snippet, and I'm going to go ahead and drop it in here. And so you guys can have a little bit of a way back machine and listen to some of our finer moments in the show. Yeah.
If friendly model is base contact with canine, they can spend an action to try to grab the...
The heck is that word?
That word? That's one of them highfalutin words, Tom.
Highfalutin words?
Recalcitrant?
What?
I don't know. It's them being British Arthurs. They put in this weird word. All right, so they can try to grab the re...
are we still on Catch That Canine? Have I missed something here?
I'm really not sure how you say that word.
Well, let's just call him. Let's just call him Frisky.
Oh, recalcitrant. It's recalcitrant. Come on, guys.
I'll call him Frisky. All right, I attempt that one.
That's recalcitrant. Okay, that's a real word, man.
SAT word for the day. What does that mean?
I'm going to go get the official definition for you. Recalcitrant.
Listen to him. He's saying it over and over again.
He's saying it well, too. Yeah. It actually sounds like how you're supposed to say it.
Having an obstinately uncooperative attitude towards authority or discipline. A person who obstinately uncooperative attitude.
So, you mean it's ornery?
It's ornery.
It's ornery. That's exactly what that...
Why did they just say so?
Because it's the British version.
But it's just Britain.
It's English ornery.
Isn't he this Britain dog? So we'd call him ornery. Okay, so
it's gonna be fun to edit.
Wait, you're gonna edit this? This
is gold. Don't edit it. That's gold. All right, so let's try that again. If a friendly model is base contact with the canine, they can spend an action to try to grab the ornery canine. The friendly model makes a strike action with a Pierce 3 penalty.
You're going to try to grab that recalcitrant canine. Okay.
Ornery. I've replaced that word with ornery.
Come on, guys. Say it with me. Recalcitrant.
I'm not even gonna try because I know. Yeah,
recalcitrant. There you go.
There you go. You pronounce it.
I said it enough that I heard it. On a success, the canine is brought down and deactivated. Remove the canine from the area of play, and the player earns 2 VPs. On a failure, the canine makes a single automatic hit on the model with a Pierce 4.
Ooh.
As it rips off a sensitive area with its teeth. It then scatters D10 inches in a random direction again. You can shoot the canine, but no VPs are earned if it is destroyed.
Damn.
Man, you're going to take a bite.
Yeah, as a mailman, this one scares me.
The postman revenge.
Yeah. Literally.
Recalcitrant. Recalcitrant. Recalcitrant.
You got your UR30 telling us what it means?
That's the new Fembot version of the UR30.
All right, we got one more peril to get through. Before we even get to the scenarios. So, yeah, that was Tom being ornery and giving both me and Brian a hard time. And These are one of those fine moments where Tom likes to get us off the rails and just throw us a curveball. So,
hey, man, reading is fundamental.
We're gonna get a model of Tom Kenny sooner or later in the game with that big old book throwing it at people. So I think for me, one of the highlights for the show, and then there's many, but the one that really sticks out in my head, and actually when I was talking to Mary about this, this was the first thing she thought of because she laughed her ass off after I edited this together, but it has to be when Tom, me and you were giving Brian a hard time because he was doing what he's doing right now. He was very into what he was working on at his painting desk, and we were trying to get his attention, so we just started ribbing him, and we kept digging and digging and digging, and we were giving him a hard time about making him a vest made out of rhinestones. And in the actual published episode, I edited in some music to it, so let's give that one a listen. And listen to me and Tom giving Brian a hard time.
Oh, yeah, because we want him to be bedazzled.
Jazz hands and a sequin jacket.
That'd be awesome at a tournament. A sequin jacket for Brian. Or, you know, Brian always wears his vest at the appearances and stuff.
No, but it's sequins now.
Yeah, sequin vest, Brian. He'll definitely be able to find where we're playing.
If we go to AdeptiCon next year and, you know, we get the team back together, y'all better not have a sequin vest.
We'll have one and you'll wear it.
Hey, Tom already said he still has, you know, the little black cowboy kid hats that are like, you know, three times
one left.
Too small for your head, so it just fits on the top of your head.
Yeah, I'll just bring my own hat.
Yeah, we'll get a bedazzler for it. It'll be great.
Mary's into crafting now. I'm sure she has something like that.
Oh, I don't know. Brian's not looking too happy right now.
No, he's not. I think in that case, the new nickname would be Rhinestone Cowboy.
The lights are shining on me like a rhinestone cowboy.
Anyway,
oh, well, nice.
We better leave Brian alone. He's going to hit us both.
I'm over here trying to paint eyebrows, and you guys are jacking me.
Oh, yeah.
So that, now that you've heard it, I'll give you some insight. I didn't think y'all were giving me a hard time.
Well, it took a while to get your attention, so we had to go to extremes.
Yeah, Brian's just in there. He's like, why? I have that.
Yeah, I know. Standard issue here in Houston. That is like a common theme. Like, people from out of state will visit and like ask, well, where's your horse? Yeah.
I left it at the rodeo.
I live in the fourth largest city in the nation. Not everyone has a horse.
So, Brian, what was your... Can you think of a favorite highlight or goofing around that we did out of the episodes?
Oh, well, let's see. Most of the goofing, I think, centers around... mispronunciation of word.
And I'm getting better.
It's not just me. So me and Eric would literally, we'll like say a word and then we just butcher it and Tom will be correcting us. And but it was like, I think prodigious.
Yeah, prodigious. Like, see, I'm getting better.
Prodigious.
Half a year. It took us half a year to Get it close? Did.
I think I was practicing in my car when I was driving places.
Hey, Tom, what's prodigious? Help me with that word, Eric.
Now you want me to say it, huh? Prodigious.
Prodigious?
Prodigious.
What is prodigious, dude, Tom?
Prodigious.
Was that new Greek model?
Tournament they're going to give these out to people. But real quick, so they have Best Painted, which has our favorite word tagged to it, prodigious. Did I say it right, Brian? I think I screwed it up again, didn't I? That's close enough.
Close enough for a Wild West game.
So, but we are getting a Dark Nation posse. Am I going to, let's see if I can butcher this one. Wakasani Dark Nation. Did I say it right or did I butcher it?
It's close enough. Faction stuff like that is Wakasanti's theme posse.
I'm glad you said that. Not me. Was looking over her stuff, and I'm like, well, she brings, you know, Carpathian that many of the Enlightened are known for. We saw some outlaw stuff, so we saw some of the Mexican Golden Army, the Bloody I can never say it, Brian.
Espinosa.
See, I can say it when you say it, Espinosa.
Well, you do kind of live in near Chicago.
Yeah.
But yeah, I have always had that kind of, you know, I'll pronounce it the way I see the words, the letters, and my brother used to tease me about it all the time. We'll be reading the same book, and pronouns are the worst, and I'll pronounce the name of a character, and he'd be like, dude, that's totally not the name of that character. I'm like, what are you talking about? Those are the letters, that sounds. He goes, no, that's not how they say the name. I'm like, oh, okay, well, how am I supposed to know? It's written text.
Well, I will have to say this, Brian, and you know, because I listen to the shows after we release them just to make sure I didn't goof something up. And if anybody has ever heard themselves talk, most people don't like listening to themselves talk, and I really don't, and yet here I edit the show. And I have noticed that, you know, everybody has a speech pattern, and I notice mine sometimes change, and I blame you, Brian. I do have a little bit of a twang, and when you get going and you get amped up sometimes, and it gets me going, and even Mary has told me that she's like, yeah, that's kind of infectious, and you start sounding a little more twangy, and I'm like, that's because Brian's getting me all amped up, he's all amped up, we're feeding off of each other, and then neither one of us can pronounce anything.
And Eric, just, you know, as a side note to that, I love hearing myself talk.
Yeah, because you say all the words, Purdy.
Someone's gotta.
Purdy. Oh, man. So it's kind of like Tom's a hall monitor.
Yeah, except I always forget to take myself off mute.
Oh, gosh. How did I forget that, Brian? How many times have we been talking, and sometimes we have the video going, and we see Tom's mouth moving and his hands moving. He's talking about something really good, but we can't hear him, and I have to yell at him, Tom, take your thing off the mute. And sometimes I cut it out, but I think after a while I started leaving it in the show, and then listeners started.
Yeah, emailing we start getting feedback about it.
I figured that would teach him.
And not even feedback, just like in the middle of it. And oh, by the way, tell Tom to get off of mute.
This is Eric here, and we are back for another episode of Fun in the Saloon. I have with me Tom out on the East Coast. Say hello, Tom. Where did Tom go?
Oh, crap. I had my thing muted. I you got a yeehaw out of me.
Oh! Damn it. Do it again. I can edit.
What? When you go, hey, Tom, I go, yeehaw!
There's Tom. But that's my runner-up. So why don't we go ahead and go to our top of the list. So our number ones. Tom, you start us off with your number one.
Wow.
Tom, awesome. You're on mute.
Damn it.
I might have to leave that in.
I thought Brian was our number one.
You switched the order.
You can't switch the order. Is that how that works? Is that how any of this works?
I'm keeping you on your toes.
On your face, you were like, blah, blah, blah. You had no idea what you were talking about.
Oh, my God.
You wonder why I run without a camera.
What?
Look into my eye.
You're supposed to pull it down. Look into my eye.
So am I doing my number one or is Brian?
Brian, go for it.
He's number one in our hearts.
Number one in our hearts. But you guys got anything kind of similar like that? I mean, I know we've had lots of experiences on the table. Any memorable experiences? Tom, I think you're on mute.
Oh, damn it, I'm always on mute.
I see your lips moving, but nothing was coming out. Both me and Tom signed up for the tournament. Tom, I think, is going to be there. Tom, are you going for sure or not? Tom, you're on mute.
See, Tom's I didn't have my mute before. You got the Muppet Show, and then I mute it, and I don't get to talk. I'm about 90%. I'll probably 90%. Be there.
Hey, at least we're not doing these live yet.
Oh, God. Well, who knows? Maybe eventually. I don't know if anybody wants to listen to that, but I'd be surprised, too. So, but yeah, so there's a little bit of reflection of doing the Blackhoof Saloon over the past year. We really hope you guys enjoy hearing our nonsense and us getting on and goofing around. You know, we spent the last year trying to, you know, give you guys a little bit of some education and, you know, learn about the game. We've been learning with you, as Brian said, you know, it kind of forces us to kind of look at stuff a little bit different. And, you know, we appreciate all you guys taking the time to listen to anything that could be from an hour and a half to us stretching out to 2 hours. I still am amazed that, you know, we read messages of people saying thank you and keep up the good work. And that really means a lot. That means what we're doing is reaching you guys. And it's appreciated that you guys are taking the time to listen to us babble. And I don't know, let's, I guess, look forward to keep going with the show. And who knows how long we can find subjects to yak about. We try to entertain you guys too when we're yakking about this stuff. And a lot of times that's us just goofing around. So, but that's us being us. Thanks, guys, for listening to the show. And you guys got anything more you guys want to add to our reflection here on the show?
Yeah, just with what you just said, if anybody has any suggestions for topics they'd like to hear or would like a more in-depth, you know, talk about things that maybe we scratched the surface on, let us know. You know, it helps to, you know, have a focus for the show, to have a topic for the show. So send in your feedback.
Yeah, definitely. We do appreciate that, and we do take that to heart. You know, we want to do what you guys want to listen to, not what we want to babble about. We try to, you know, the three of us talk about what would be a good subject, and I think we pretty much come up with some good topics for everybody to listen to. And, you know, some of this stuff that we've come up with has been actually suggestions from you guys, so keep it up. Brian, anything for closing on reflecting of a year of Blackhoof Saloon?
Like I said, I really like the dialogue we have with the community. So I want to hear what you guys, I want to hear what the community's favorite moments were. Comment on any of our multimedias. So, you know, just throw up a comment somewhere, giving us a you know, your favorite moment. And
there's probably a lot we forgot about.
Yeah, I know, right? And of course, I know there's a lot of funny things that never made it to tape. So,
yeah,
because yeah, we'll be done laughing about it, and Eric will go, "Yeah, I can't put that in."
Yeah. Then there's also the stuff that we talk about before the record button is actually hit too.
Oh, so. Damn! I need that bag of ice. All right, well, we're going to go ahead and move on from our little intro here of reflecting of our one-year anniversary of Blackhoof Saloon, and we hope you guys enjoy the rest of the show and what we got planned for you. So let's go ahead and go into our first main topic today, where we're going to talk about synergies in list building and talk about how we look at it, and, you know, we're just going to deep dive into it, so let's get to it.
All right, so here's the segment. It's we're going to expand on list building. Over the year since we've done all of the episodes, one of our most referred to episodes for new players is episode 2 when we did list building. That episode, we each brought in a different way of building a list. And it was just the mechanics of how, you know, the rules. And then we showed you examples of what a list looks like. We didn't actually talk about how the determination of what you bring for the slots was. So this conversation you're going to hear us go over is going to be more about the why. You know, why are we bringing so-and-so over someone else? So stay tuned. Listen in. Some of you who like to take notes, get your pen out. that's what we're going to do. We're going to discuss, you know, the why we make choices during list building. So Eric.
Okay.
What do you have for list that we're going to dive into?
Like, we're list building. Some of the things that you want to look at is kind of how the different units go together. They create some kind of synergy. Or, you know, maybe they give you, you know, they buff out an ability of somebody else. So that's kind of something to think about and look at when you're doing this. And, you know, you're making decisions. So why am I going to take this person? So, I have a list that I ran at AdeptiCon, and what I'll do is, so we kind of want to just give you guys a little bit of example of how we do this, why we're doing this, and so the list that I took is, it's an outlaw list that I ended up putting in, not just Jesse James, but legendary Jesse James. Now, the decision of why legendary over his regular model, pretty simple. I wanted the more fortune. So, you know, not too complicated there. But his stats are a little bit higher. He's got maybe a little bit different abilities. Like, for one of his abilities is he has Sic'em. So, you know, I look at that ability and I think about, okay, how can I use this? Of course, you throw in some dogs, whether they're the gun dogs or the attack dogs. So then it's like, I'm going to put that, keep those dogs next to him. I can benefit off of them. After Jesse goes, I can basically activate the dogs right after he's done. So that's a quick example of why I would do that. And, you know, you look at the slots and you kind of, you know, in our previous episode, we were just talking about, you know, you go to the next one. This is the unit you can put in there. and looking deeper into it. So let me go ahead and spread these cards out so I can read them, and I can easily go over them then. What I did is it's outlaw posse. It's a double boss posse. So we got Legendary Jesse, and then I put some Raider gunmen in there. So the gunmen are filling up a slot that says I can have a mercenary hands unit. So I put in the Raider gunmen, not so much because they're ranged, but my thought behind the process was to protect Jesse. So they're basically meant to just be meat shields, and if somebody's shooting at Jesse, he can, you know, say, take one for the team and nominate one of these schlubs next to him, and then they can take the hit. You know, they're a cheap unit, so they're not going to be expensive. And then they do have a little bit of versatility that I can use them if I have to, you know, shoot something or, you know, use them to obtain an objective. Like I can throw them in a building on higher ground and they can just sit in the building. And, you know, I don't have to worry about them. Oh, I gotta go after this guy with these guys. So a lot of these choices, you got to think about what can I do with this unit? And you want to kind of cover your bases, have some kind of diversity in your posse build. We were just talking about this too, how me and you can't talk, and I'm already losing it.
and remarkably, Tom didn't mention it, so he must have muted himself.
He probably muted himself.
God damn it.
So, moving on in my list.
Pronounce things better.
I'll try. Probably too much coffee doesn't help. So, next, I put Slain in there. So, Slain's kind of an easy pick. He's got the nasty weapon in the game with the -4 pierce, the ammo clip. He's a scary model. And I'll admit, I put him in there because he draws a lot of attention. So, while he's on one end of the board, well, some of my posse on the other end can be achieving other objectives. So, that's kind of simple. He draws attention. And so, meanwhile, on the other side of the board, I have units like Nakano, who's fast. She is a hands-killing machine. Just the fact that she can, you know, go through units of hands doing those second attacks for just, you know, one less action point. But the main reason I put her in there is because of her giving you an extra adventure card. Now, there's another character in this posse that I put in there that can do it. I don't benefit from both of them, but it gives me a backup. So I have two people that will give me an extra adventure card. If one of them dies, well, I still have the other guy. Next, I put gun dogs in there. And like I mentioned earlier, the gun dogs really work well with Jesse if I have him by Jesse. After he goes, he can trigger them with the Sic'em rule. And then I said it was a double boss list. Well, who do I want to put in here? I put Marcus in here. Not just Marcus on his feet, I put him on a bike. So now he's really fast. He can shoot into melee with his peacemaker that's a -4, and he's got Gatling guns. So he's just, it's another kind of nasty guy that has a lot of fortune. Unfortunately, anybody that's in his part of the posse can only use that. But, you know, he's just nasty. And then going along with Marcus, I put K-Free. Now, K-Free is in there because, like I mentioned, gun dogs. I have Marcus on a bike, and K-Free is also on a bike. But, so, she's mainly in there because of repair. So, if the whole strategy there is what I'm looking at doing is keeping her by the dogs so the dogs can get repair. Or if Marcus is close to her, he can get repair because he's on a machine. He's on the bike. So, that's kind of how I went through this list building. There was a couple different versions of this. You know, I tried something out. I put a unit in there and said, oh, let's try this. And, I play tested it. some things didn't work. So then you go back and you tweak it a little bit. Oh, let's try this unit, because this unit maybe helps this guy out a little bit more. Or maybe they bring something that your posse was building. You know, this guy can get up to this objective better and hold it better. So that's some of my thought processes of when I'm posse building and my decisions for, you know, making the this kind of list.
Do you have any thoughts on that, Tom? Comment?
Let me just take myself off mute first. Aha. See, I'm learning.
Aha.
No, I think it's great. I think the things that I particularly like in it is using Slane, not just, I mean, obviously he's hugely powerful, but using him for the misdirection.
Oh, yeah.
Using him as a distraction. I mean, I know I see a minus four on the board. I'm going for it.
Yeah.
I want that off the board. You know, so.
Well, one of my favorite tricks I use with Slane is I tend to sometimes, it depends on the adventure cards. So there's a adventure card that will give you points if you have a face, take one for the team. So there's been times where I'll throw Jesse out there to the wind and he's kind of just hanging out there, and I'm trying to bait somebody to come shoot him. Well, they forget that Slane's right next to him, and he's got on the lookout or something like that. So they can target Jesse. I can pay a fortune to take one for the team, Slane, and then Slane can shoot before they shoot, and then, you know, I can claim a victory point. So I'm doing a lot of misdirection with him and misleading and trying to draw, you know, I rush them up fairly early so people get concerned right away, and then they forget, oh, there's other units here, or, oh, there's Marcus over here that's really fast and can zoom up to the, you know, the other opponent's, you know, deployment zone fast, so.
And that was the other one that I was saying I really like is that, you know, Marcus on the bike. I think people don't think about mounting characters because they're not available yet. You have to kit bash them yourself.
Yeah, and that's what I end up having to do with this posse is I kit bashed Marcus and K-Free with their old versions of the models, which, you know, I had extra ones sitting around, so I didn't mind cutting them up.
Right, and so I think people forget that you can mount a lot of different characters in this game.
Yeah,
and I think that's a pretty awesome thing that you did there.
I mean, now one of the things that I did have to decide on with that is so when he's like Marcus is mounted and K-Free's mounted, they don't have Quicken the Dead anymore being mounted. But what they do have is if they moved, they get moving target. So, you know, yeah, I'm losing something, but what am I gaining? That's another thing to think about when you're making your decisions of who do I put in the slot in your posse.
Yep.
Yeah, one of the things you didn't mention when you added Marcus to this army was you mentioned Nakano Gozen's Treasure Hunter.
Yes,
but you didn't mention Marcus Wayward also has Treasure Hunter.
Yes, so that's right. So Marcus is the other one that has it. He's my backup.
Yeah,
or so Nakano's my backup.
Right. So you definitely layered those extra cards that, you know, which is nice. You kind of, you know, built your own synergy by those choices. So it's pretty nice.
I mean, like I said, it did have some trials. So, I think at one point I had more of those hands in there. But then I was like, but I want one more dog. And then I think the dogs went through, do I take a bunch of Gatlings or do I diversify? And I ended up keeping two of them as flamethrowers and then two of them as Gatling guns. So to give me a variety on based on the situation. Yeah, I got gun dogs. I can go guns blazing at somebody in a building, but those flamethrowers are a lot more effective when you can engulf that entire building and everybody in there takes that hit. Yeah, it's fun. It's, you know, when you look at posse building this way, it's kind of a game inside the game. And I know there's a lot of the people out there that list building sometimes is more fun than actually, you know, playing the game because of the possibilities of what you can do.
No, the game's still.
Yeah, you're probably right. All right. Who's got some more insights into this kind of thinking for posse building and deciding why you would take somebody?
Well, I'll go next, I guess, because I did build out also for Adepticon a list to play. Even though in the end I ended up not being able to go, I did have to actually prepare for it. So
you painted a model.
I painted a model and everything. God. I feel so ripped off now that I couldn't get to go just because of that. So this was an interesting exercise because I knew going in I was going to play Lawmen. That's my main faction. I have basically the majority of the faction owned and built and painted. So I kind of knew that going in ahead of time. I was looking at the different bosses, and originally I thought I was going to go with a Wyatt Earp led posse. And the more I played around with it, I found I didn't like how his posses fell out. And I actually ended up going with Armored Justice, which I didn't expect, because when Armored Justice came out, I was like, I don't like that. I don't want to play that. I don't want to have anything to do with that. Until I actually really started playing around with the list building for it. And it got more interesting for me. First off, when I build a posse, I'm almost always going to go with a themed posse. I care less whether I'm going to win or lose, and more just about having some fun with it.
Yeah, definitely more fun that way.
Yep. And I just feel they're more thematic, and yes, I can mix and match a little easier with the non-themed posses, but I just don't find that as interesting. So I decided to go with Armored Justice. So I started off with Legendary Morgan Earp. The reason I went with the Legendary is Suspenders McGee is just underwhelming to me. There's really very little about him that I like.
I had to get Suspenders.
Come on. Yeah, he's got to hold his iron pants up. Great. So I went with the Legendary version. There were a number of reasons why I went with that, with him, you know, other than the fact that I don't like the non-Legendary version of him. He's got the Gatling gun built in, which is very nice. He's got the Liberty Gatling gun. But another important piece there to me is one, he's very durable. He's an incredibly durable character. He's going to be around for a while, and he has the Electro Net Launcher, and I'll get to why that's important, because that'll be the last slot that I deal with in the building of this. But just keep in mind, he's got the Electro Net Launcher that drags, it tangles. And Tangle basically puts, what is it, Disorient and Stun on them, I believe? I forget which one exactly. So that's why he's there. After that, I started looking at what units are actually available. So the way Armored Justice works is slot one is a Lawman Automata unit. Automata. God, I can never say that right. Automata. Thank you.
And we didn't correct you.
Well, because you knew I would correct myself.
Correct. He corrected himself.
But that's the same thing for the first three units. So the first three bullets in here, you have to take those types of units. And there's a very limited number of units you can look at for that. So the first one I picked was the UR31. C heavy lawbot. This guy's just awesome. So his grenade repeater is fantastic. It's just a very strong weapon. And then obviously he's got, you know, metal durable. Because of the bonus of using this theme posse, they're not tasked, so I can split target fire with them. So it's just a really great unit to have, and it just stays around for a long time. You know, and then with Tin Man, just keep them together, gets plus one grit. And so the idea of this posse in general is you have very durable units that should probably hang around for a little while. Second slot just went with standard UR30 law bots. And, sorry, first slot, there was two of those UR31 bots. In the second slot, I took five UR30 bots at 50 points each. They're fairly affordable, and they just fit in nicely. Same reasons as the heavy law bot. This is it's almost like playing a hands unit. You know, they're not hands, but they kind of take that role in this posse. But again, they've got the tin man for the plus one grit. They're durable. Yeah, their weapons aren't great, but, you know, they can stun in melee if they need to, you know, which obviously opens up some other options for other characters to follow up with. And they've just got their regular pistols. But, I mean, they're taking the place of a hands unit. They are what they are. They're going to bring some fire to bear. They can use up some rolls, maybe force someone to go through their fortune a little bit. So, or just stick them somewhere to hold an objective. The next one that I put in there was Blackhoof 2020. When I came across him, I was like, oh, that's nice. I can put him there. Blackhoof 2020 is actually a little underwhelming. Yeah, he's got that minus three piercing weapon, but it's a rate of attack of one. So it's not the greatest thing, but it's not terrible either. It gives you a little bit of something with pierce in there. And he is incredibly, incredibly durable. He's got tough. He's got durable. He's got quick in the dead. You know, he's got a grit of six, so he's just around.
Yeah, he's going
to
be
he's hard to take out. Yeah, so, you know, and basically, but he was really filler to take up that slot so I could get to the next slot, which I actually really care about. So in the next slot, you could take a lawman automata unit or a lawman support vehicle unit. So this is where it gets more fun. I get the support units. So I took a three Ranger interceptors. Ranger interceptors to me are one of the best units that Rangers have. They're fast. They bring strong weapons to bear, and they really just give you a little bit of force projection for a posse or for a faction that's actually, you know, fairly slow. You know, everyone moves at pretty much a quickness of five. So it's a sort of a slow plotting faction, and so it gives them a little bit of force projection there, so you can get them wherever they need to go quickly and put a lot of firepower onto something. They don't go along with anything. They're just a quick response unit or something that you can send ahead, soften up a target, try to hold something. That's what they're there for. Next bullet, a lawman automata unit or a lawman face unit. This is the only face unit that you can really take in this posse. So I really agonized over this one. I was looking at Nakano Gozen for a while, and that was a completely different setup if I took her because of how the points worked out. But you know, she's such a melee beast. I felt like she brought something different to this posse, and so I really considered her for a while. But I ended up going with Jed Powell. He was originally put in here because I was like, oh, I'm sure he synergizes really well with Blackhoof 2020. Well, no, he doesn't at all. So I was wrong about that. But he does a lot of different things. He can lay about him with his stun batons and you know, put guys on the ground, which is great for a number of reasons, whether it's somebody's to follow up or, again, when I get to the last slot here. He's also got a lasso. Lasso gives tangle and gives drag. Basically, I want that for the same reasons that I wanted Morgan Earp with his electronet launcher. And with drag, yes, it only happens on a crit, but I can reposition characters, and there's a lot of value for that in this particular posse. You know, and you know, he does Jed things. Jed kind of is a little bit of a Swiss Army knife. He can do a lot of different things. You know, you have the things that he can do with looking at the top cards and discarding. You know, there's always value in knowing what's coming up. So that's what he's there for. And the reason why I cared so much about the stun and the tangles is the last slot is a lawman automata unit and or a lawman support vehicle unit. And as that support vehicle, I am bringing the judgment. Judgment is a big, scary unit, especially when there's a lot of stun and tangle on the board because of incarceration. For those that don't know, with incarceration, at the end of this unit's activation, D5 plus one stunned or disordered small-based enemy models within 8 inches are immediately removed from the play area. If I'm laying about with Morgan and with Jedrick, and to a lesser extent with the Lawbots, you know, basically just stunning and disordering units, the Judgment can just roll in there as long as it's within 8 inches, and those units are just gone. And that is a scary, scary prospect. So that was why I put this together that way. You know, a little bit had to do with what I had painted and ready to go, but again,
counts. That really still counts.
But I was really surprised at how this came out. I was surprised at the fact that I ended up not using canines. I didn't use gun dogs. I was expecting to have, you know, units filled with those, but I just didn't have the points for it. But I really, the linchpin in this is the Judgment sitting in the middle of everything and rolling in behind units that are really worried more about laying about with status effects than, you know, killing things. I just want you knocked down so that the Judgment can roll in behind you and say, okay, you're off the board. So, and that's really what the kind of the entire strategy of this is built around.
So I'd like that, you know, you picked kind of that one bit and you built on that. So like, it doesn't have to be, I mean, you do have, you know, diversatility in it. But you took a concept and you built on it. I think that's a great part about this, and it makes it fun. Like you said, you went with the theme posse and you made it fun. So it's going to be fun to play. And then like the other point that when you're talking, Tom, is you're talking about 2020, and you put him in that slot basically because he just fills it. Sometimes you, when you're looking at list building and deciding who to take, sometimes you have to do that in order to get to that next slot, to get that really big unit that you want to put in. And there's nothing wrong with that. 2020 is still of some kind of value. He's still going to draw people's attention. He's still going to, you know, muck things about on the board. So, you know, I think that's something to think about too.
Yeah. I mean, he's not useless. You know, he's not garbage, but he's not as robust as you would hope for something of its point cost, I guess, is really what it comes down to. But like you said, I needed something to get to that next slot. And it just filled in nicely.
All right. And those of you who have any suggestions to offer up feedback to what could improve 2020, feedback form for cards is still active on the website.
Brian, you sound very hopeful there.
Well, I mean,
honestly, I think if you turned his rifle into a rate of attack of 2, instead of 1,
it would make his point cost make sense. Yeah.
Yes, and maybe make hammer hands a piercing -2 instead of a piercing -1, because then his forceful strike will actually be of some sort of value. Because right now, the only thing it does is increase the cost of the model. Because woohoo, I'm going to spend my one and only fortune to take my pierce 1 to make it into a pierce 2. Not, you know, that's a little underwhelming.
Yeah. Not very forceful.
Not at all.
Yeah, especially considering every other model that most of the other models that have forceful strike have higher pierce melee weapons. So for him to have it, I know that's why his point value is so high, but he can't capitalize off of that ability.
No.
So there could be some future upgrades for him.
Because frankly, if that was there, all of a sudden he would synergize with Jed pretty well.
Yeah.
If he could roll in after Jed knocked a bunch of guys down and spend his one fortune to increase that piercing from like a minus two to a minus four. Now you're talking. Now you have a reason to spend his only fortune. You'd have a reason for that forceful strike to be there, increasing the point cost. I think that would be.
Well, you also then cause the duo of those two to be able to take out more than just hands, because Jedrick is really good versus hand, because the entire unit ends up getting the stun.
Right, but then Blackhoof just sort of stares at it and goes, well, I guess I'll shoot that one guy.
Right. There's a few models, not just with 2020, but there's a few tweaks that hopefully feedback for the next card set. We'll see some models gain usefulness where they've been kind of stagnant because of the current rule set. So
yeah, I think just tweak those two little values there just by one, and I think he's all of a sudden goes from meh to wow.
Yeah. So moving on, we may even touch back with some of the stuff because of my list build. So I basically play lawmen most of the time, occasionally dabble in my order. My main themes in Wild West Texas currently are law and order.
These are their stories.
Unintended. So
I see what you did there.
Currently, I like using Helena Miller. She brings a lot of abilities to the posse that she runs. So she has Treasure Hunter. She also has the ability to rearrange the top three cards of either deck, which is really useful when you're planning ahead. So when you're playing chess, knowing what's coming can help. So I use that regularly. Once I discovered it, I now look forward to having her do that at least twice during a game. It's expensive, but it takes two extra points, but very useful. Especially if she's not in a position to do anything, you definitely want to go ahead and just use those points to set up your next couple of moves. So she also has pistols, range 10, with disrupt. And it is extremely brutal versus machines and, you know, automatons. And that's where she really shines, is when she's up against, you know, anything that has machine or robot or something like that, because she just really hammers them bad with that pistol. It's a rate of attack 3, really good pierce, and it just I loved the face I made of opponents when they have a vehicle and it just evaporates under her barrage. You know, so very effective. So when I go from there, when I first started using the Infernal Investigations posses, I went straight up trying to get to that fifth slot of the posse, because it triggers Prodigious, which gives all of their
very focus good.
Right? There's always a pause right before me and Eric said Prodigious.
I was gonna say you can hear him like take a deep breath before saying it.
Oh, here it comes. but it adds plus 3 versus a plus 2. But the biggest thing when I was playing games with that is when you play only faces, you can be out-activated, and it can cause some issues. So I kind of started changing the way I build lists to make sure I bring in some hands, because they're very useful. So when I've been playing a lot of 1,000 games, obviously we can play it to 1,500, you won't need to worry about that, because you can then start bringing in other stuff with the second boss. But playing at 1,000, what I've done is I go for the lawmen faction posse. So it changes some things. It allows me to bring in some of my ranger hands, and then she picks up Jedrick. So my last list I brought in Jedrick, and then I brought in a group of the ranger hands, and then I switch it up a little, and I jump over and I bring in Bass Reeves. Bass Reeves pistols are very good. and he has his own, a lot of fortune. So with Jedrick and Elena in their posse, they have five fortune. Well, I bring in Bass Reeves. He's also a very high fortune. And then I bring in one more person in his posse, and that is I bring in Nakano Gozen. So what that does,
woo-hoo,
it brings me two treasure hunters, because Lena Mill is also a trainer, a treasure hunter. And then Nakano goes and brings in a treasure hunter. So what I do is I have Nakano follow Jedrick around, so he has a melee beast to follow up, you know, all these stuns. But then I also have Bass Reeves, who between the two of them, they're sharing another huge pool of fortune. So it's pretty good. And of course I have the hands, you know, really, because they can lock down targets, you know, they can lock down a building.
Yeah.
Lockdown gives, and it makes them a little harder to weed out. And it also gives my Jedrick and the other melee guys to run, really get up in your face. So it's a gamble, but it seems to work, because I will go straight across the board with my melee guys and really harry my opponent rather quickly.
Yeah, having all those hands units, it's like something that Tom brought up last episode when we were talking about list building for adventures. You're building numbers into it, so it's like it's harder for your opponent to deal with, you know, like five hands versus one face, you know, because yeah, you can kill them fairly easy and get them off the board, but you got to go through five of them, so they're going to be hanging around there a little bit longer. So that's definitely a good thing to think about when you're list building is, yeah, it you know, they're not really going. I mean, it's kind of like what I talked about. The hands are there, not so much for just killing somebody. They're there to help you achieve your objectives, whether it's just being pure numbers and being a nuisance, or like I said, just be there to take a shot for your boss, you know?
Right, exactly. So what I've done is this list I built up to 1,500, and a few things change. So when you get to 15, I have a little more flexibility, and that's when I bring in some more diversity. Like Eric just mentioned with the hands, it allows you to be able to tackle objectives a little easier while your faces and your bosses attack the other side. Then you have some of these these hand units being able to help, you know, tactically secure objectives or other objectives, maybe some victory cards. So what I do is Helena still brings Jedrick first, but in the second slot, the second slot enables you to do a couple of things. It allows you to bring a face and a support unit. So what I do is I bring Furio and then two interceptors. And then with Bass Reeves, instead of just Nakanagono, in slot two, he brings Behringer and some Rangers.
Okay. So you're really stretching out your, you know, where you can do more with all those guys and doing the different objectives. And based on what your cards are, you can probably achieve more of those. And, yeah.
You pull in those almighty interceptors. Which again gives you some force projection and again they just add flexibility. They let you do some things that you can't do otherwise on foot.
Right.
So, we've been hearing about this list for a number of months now. as you beat up on new players and teach them not to mess with you. I learned a lot from this list, actually, over the months. This list is one that I appreciate a lot. It kind of taught me the power of status effects and why you don't just go for the jugular every time you roll the dice.
Yeah.
Because that's a losing proposition, really. There's so many ways to keep your characters alive. in this game. Yeah, you know, yeah, one wound and you're done, you're out. But there's just a good number of ways to mitigate that. And at putting status effects on people really makes it harder for them to mitigate those wounds that they take. And that, you know, probably that's probably the biggest takeaway that I took from this posse that, that Brian put together is that, hey, don't just shoot somebody because it doesn't work very often. So, you know, really do other things to them first that makes it harder or impossible for them to mitigate those wounds from somebody else. And I took that to heart when I was list building.
Yeah, you definitely, it's this, the new game is more about achieving those objectives and scoring points and not wiping your opponent off the board. There's, you know, we hear about people that, yeah, I basically wiped out everybody, but I still lost. Probably because the other posse was built to achieve different objectives. You know, they were, it was built to get this objective, or, you know, maybe they built it so, okay, this one guy that has a -4 piercing can capitalize on an adventure card and take out the other player's boss or a face or, you know, shoot a hands unit. So that's something to think about, you know, when you're deciding on who do I put in this posse.
Well, also the tactical use of some of the card shenanigans abilities.
Yeah.
I mean, they're huge, but a lot of people look at the cards and only look at what the glory could do for them, or they only look at it for what the guts can give them. I know my first few games, I was only using cards for guts.
Yeah.
And I realized that you can get outscored really quickly if all you're paying attention to is the objective. Because, you know, a lot of the objectives, they're uneven. So if you're on the losing side of the uneven objectives, the only way you can compete is to either beat them at those, you know, objectives. Like one of them is there's three objectives. And so someone's always going to be on top, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's hard to overturn that. But if you play the cards and, you know, with Helena and Nakano, you know.
So that was supply run, Brian, with the three objectives in the middle. Yeah.
Right. So when you have extra cards, that allows you to still use them for guts when you need to, but it gives you so many more options to really capitalize on obtaining some of the glory. And I remember I literally, between like two of my activations, I use all the cards. And mind you, this is a 1,000-point list, so, you know, you're only supposed to have three. But I literally use off cards in really quick succession and ended up securing two victory points from cards, but then also objective points from the scenario we were playing. And it was like my opponent literally was stunned. Because I just kept dropping down cards over and over again. And then I capped it off, was like, oh, and since I did that, I had two cards for take out a face.
Yeah. I have a local player that he pulls that stuff all the time where I don't know how he gets those multiple cards of the same thing. And it always does it. I'm just like, you son of a...
Kind of like... when you play and you have Jesse James or Doc Holliday on the table and you use Gambler.
Yeah.
And you pull it off. Now they have no limit.
You can just go to town. As long as you have the action points and fortune.
And have an extra cards.
Yeah.
You know, being able to use those for action points. It just kind of steamrolls and, you know, there's a lot of that kind of tactics that you know, be open to, because it can really be good. Like, so Jedward can look at the top card, right? Well, if Doc is in his group and I look at the top card, it's a one. Now, most of the time you're like, oh, well, I'm going to, because his ability allows him to discard that.
Yeah.
Well, now it's like, if I got Doc in the group,
yep.
I might not. I might let Doc pull that card.
Yep. That's something.
That the next card is likely not to be another one.
Yeah.
The odds are in his favor to be able to pull off an unlimited run. And especially if you have all these cards in advance, knowing, hey, I've got a +2 action point. I've got a +1 action point. I have, some other cards that can support him getting a really good run. My boss has all their fortune still. And then you can just roll through it.
Yeah. See, that's very similar. Like with Nakano, one of my deciding factors with putting her in my list is she can kind of do the same thing where she can use shrewd strategist and look at the top card of one of the decks and either decide to leave it there or discard it. So I can set up Jesse. So like say it's a 1 and I haven't activated Jesse yet, I can leave that 1 there. And if I have a lot of fortune still sitting on him and a lot of cards in my hand, I can set him up then through Nakano that his next turn, I'm going to flip that 1 and know that, okay, I'm going to gamble. And I'm pretty sure that I am not going to get a 1 again.
Yeah, and that's, because she is such a shrewd strategist.
What did I say? What did I say? Strategist. I probably said something wrong.
I said strategist.
Strategist? Man, man, oh, man.
That's all right. I said automata.
Automata you.
Anyway, so that's I think that kind of sums up our little discussion here before we get too winded into it. But that's, how we decide and why we decide to put certain units in posse list. And keep in mind, you want to kind of play off of each other units, or maybe like with Tom's, Tom built kind of a cover all the bases type thing. So that's also another thing that you got to think about when you're looking at list building. You guys got anything else to add to that closing? That wasn't fantastic.
We out.
I mean, I think that really what you need to do is play some games and figure out, what works for you, what doesn't work for you, figure out your play style, and then start building to support what your play style is.
Yep.
Maybe some people want to go all in on one strategy. Other people may want to spread out and cover all bases. There's not really any right or wrong. There's what works for you.
Yep, well said. So we'll go ahead and get out of here, guys, and I hope that helps you guys in a little bit of list building and gives you stuff to think about when you're starting one of the posse themes, whether it's just a faction posse or a theme posse, and have some fun with it. It's what it's all about. Hey there, guys. At the beginning of the month, we had AdeptiCon 2019, and Warcradle had some big news there with the tease release of a new game, Lost World Exodus. At the end of that weekend, me and Brian got to sit down with Stuart to chat about the new game, which can be heard on our sideshow, Blackhoof Saloon Ramblin' Episode 2, which you guys can find in the same feed as all our other episodes of the main show. In the chat, we, of course, had questions for Stuart about Wild West Exodus that we wanted to save for the main show here. And in that chat, we got some insight of the game and what's coming down the line for Wild West Exodus, like
Redacted.
And even for some of the factions, like
Redact this, Redact that.
So let's jump into the conversation where we started up with Wild West Exodus and hear what Stuart has to say. Enjoy, guys. All right, so me and Brian wanted to switch gears on you a little bit and go into our beloved Wild West Exodus. And we had questions. So going along with our next card update, What kind of rules or things are you guys at the studio looking at in the next card update for Wild West Exodus?
We're just trying to smooth things out in the rule set. It's also about, so there's a couple of core rules, not core rules, but there's a couple of rules that have been just kind of reworked because they weren't working quite as intended. So we're rejigging those. There's also some future proofing because there is a shared rule set with Lost World Exodus. There are some things we're doing in Lost World Exodus that will require some of the rules to just be slightly tweaked how they work.
Okay.
And then there's the main thrust of it, though, is to make sure that every unit in the game is interesting and is worth taking. And now we've had a couple. Yeah, we've had a year of seeing what people take, seeing how people play, and we know we've already got a list of units that need maybe either a little bit. It's not necessarily just adding numbers to them or anything. Sometimes it's just, well, okay, this character, this boss, this face or whatever, it's not quite interesting enough, or there's nothing that, you know, what was maybe perhaps special about this. So for example, Wild Bill Hickok is less interesting a character now than he deserves to be, because when he first came out he had some cool stuff about him, but now we've got quite a few people with sniper rifles and the other stuff. So let's go back to Wild Bill and let's really kind of make sure that
I think Wild Bill, Warren Earp, and Pat are very similar.
Yeah.
So that's three that when you look at them, who are you going to pick? There's, you know, it's like flip a coin because they're very similar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I can see what you mean. And there's also quite a few of the outlaws that literally they have the same guns. They have the same abilities, and looking at them to maybe see what we can do to
make them stand out, basically.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I want every character, I want every unit in the game to be something that somebody seriously looks at and thinks, oh, that's interesting. Okay. Well, how can I fit that into my force or what have you? It can't just be, well, I want Slain. I want, Bass Reeves or Wyatt Earp. I want this guy. I want that guy. And I'll have Creation 7. You know, it can't just be these 8 or 9 real heavy hitter, really almost like a no-brainer units to include. I'll have Raven Spirit. I'll have Ghost Wolf Legendary. There needs to be, a kind of a wider range of options for people. So that's what we want at 1.09.
Okay.
Awesome.
All right, Brian.
All right, so here's the big one, the big question. Okay, so as a design team, when you sit down and plan out what you're going to throw at the public, so you're creating new boss posse boxes. So what do you look at to decide on either fleshing out a posse behind an existing boss versus creating a new boss to fill with faces? Like, how do y'all approach that decision-making process?
Well, there's a lot less of them now. In existing stuff, it's all either been so. It's like there are, I think, about 5 posse boxes on the way, that posse sets on the way, that pretty much fill out the range. So the Cowboys, the Regulators, Dead or Alive, Veterans of the Or War, they between them have kind of covered most of the outstanding characters that are missing from the range. But in terms of then when we're creating something new, so like Veterans of the Or War was interesting. So the boss for Veterans, we knew we wanted a new boss for Veterans of the Or War. We wanted another Confederate boss, but it needed to be somebody or a character that was different to what we had before. So in this instance, I mean, it's not quite a box ticking exercise. It's just about what's interesting. So we looked at some historical figures, and we were like, okay, this is interesting. This person's interesting. I mean, the Civil War is interesting anyway, because there are most of the leadership of the Civil War obviously older, which means now we're 15, 20 years down the line, or 15 years down the line. Not only are they older, they are really quite elderly by the terms of the time. So it becomes less realistic that so somebody in their 50s who is a commander in the Confederacy in their 50s now would be, well, probably dead, even not of not of war injuries, but actually just of old age.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. Yeah, so, I mean, even with the enlightened science, but then that takes you down a very different route in terms of unit design. So we looked at things. The dystopian age isn't our world, so we get to play around with things. So, for example, we knew that we looked at what was going to be in the posse. We looked at these other characters, and it's basically a load of guys. So we're like, okay, well, it needs to be a woman. We don't have any Confederate women per se, or female Confederate bosses. We have Annabelle Hamilton, but she's an enlightened boss that has Confederate leanings rather than a proper Confederate boss. But actually, she never served in the Confederacy. She was too young. She was a child when the war was raging. So. So we knew we wanted a commander or a, not a, see, I can't use that word anymore now. We knew we wanted a general or a major, a senior figure who would have served in the Confederate Army during the Civil War, the Or War, and has continued to fight. So almost like, not quite a female Stonewall Jackson, because the story needed to be different, but certainly somebody of that ilk, a person that wasn't giving up, somebody that wasn't going to surrender, or even if she did surrender because she had to, but somebody was going to keep the fight going. She doesn't trust the Union. She doesn't trust, or she believes that the Union need to be stopped because they are aggressively and militarily pushing in all directions, this whole notion of manifest destiny. So, so we came up with this new character, and we had a bit of fun with the name. So she's Jubilee Early is her name. Jubilee is her first name. Early. She's Jubilee Early, and she is a Confederate commander with a small C. She's a Confederate leader. We looked at how... I mean, at one point we thought, well, we can't really put her on a bike have her mounted. At one point we were thinking about her being on a black hoof, but we've got mounted Confederates on the way with the Quantrill and his raiders, so we didn't go there. And in the end we settled on the Terminators, and we looked at the... So she's got the... It's not Terminator armour, but she has... basically a set of customized, like an exoskeleton armor type thing. And the idea being, because again, it ties in with the, so she's a bit elderly, well, she's not elderly, but she's in her 50s. So she would be picking up the odd war injury in that. So having this exo frame and she continues to wear it is a way of kind of offsetting the fatigues of old age, and she can continue to fight. So yes, so we have this interesting new character. She'll be on a medium base, so again, she'll be quite a solid looking figure. She's got a nice sculpt, because I've seen it. She goes very well with the re-sculpted Slain and everybody else.
All right. Well, how about, next question we got for you is about current posse support. Brian, how did you word this to me? I can't get it out.
Okay. So we've been getting pretty consistent monthly Wild West Exodus releases, and love the spoilers that really energizes the public quite a bit. So do encourage, keep doing that. That's awesome. But we kind of get a trend of a posse box, maybe one or two, and then like a support box with one or two models in it. And then a piece of terrain. Is this kind of like a consistent plan for the Wild West Exodus label, is to consistently get that kind of,
monthly release?
we're getting a monthly release from us. You're not going to not get a monthly release. You will always get a monthly release from us.
Well, I meant the layout of a box,
okay,
and then the support models. At some point,
unless we've got lots of other things to release in that month, you will almost always get a posse box coming out every month.
Okay.
You're unlikely to get. I mean, I think last year at one point we had three posse boxes come out the same month. That is a rarity. You're likely to get one. Occasionally, you might get two. It depends on what the release schedule is looking like. And then there'll be some other box sets to kind of support. They're not necessarily supporting what's come out, but they may be to go along with things. So, for example, we have a Watchers posse coming out fairly soon, which has the content of two other box sets within it. And so those themselves then come out separately a little later down the line. So there's a mix of stuff. Usually if the posse set is all faces or what have you, then we'll usually have, we'll use that as an opportunity to bring out some sort of other hands or other add-on bits of support or something,
okay,
for other factions. On the other hand, if it comes out with, like we did with the Hour of the Wolf, well, we had the Hunting Wolves could then come out separately, and so did the Wayland Spirit Walkers. So, yeah, it depends on what the release is as to specifically what comes out alongside it or very soon thereafter. But, you will see... you'll see that mix of stuff. Terrain-wise, we've got some great terrain coming. We've kind of fleshed out most of Red Oak, to be fair. We've covered most building types. We have a couple more buildings coming out, which kind of fill in some fairly obvious gaps that still aren't in the town. So,
okay.
As we haven't worked out, well, we haven't established what happens when you die, so that needs to be... That needs to be covered. but we'll do that. But there's also other parts of the setting. So, what's going on in slightly wetter climes in the Union, where what terrain would be out that way.
Okay.
So there's more to do.
Let me know. I'm from Louisiana. The wetter climbs. You need a name for that town,
it's not our intention to do a whole town, but certainly because really, we don't want to just do like five or six more buildings in different shape. But there are certain types of terrain that are more unique to different climates that you wouldn't find in the middle of. The Arizonan desert, for example, scrubland. There are certain terrain, certain scenic types that, we're going to bring out because I think they're quite cool. But it'll all be revealed in a few months because I think the first one comes out in 2-3 months' time.
Okay. So plenty of places for us to explore and have adventures in.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Awesome. And then the last question we have, and then. We'll tie this all up, is what can we expect for each of the Wild West Exodus factions for this year?
What do you mean?
Whatever you want to talk about.
He's fishing here, Stuart. He's fishing.
Right. It's like, so everyone has their favorite faction. So do you have anything that you want to tease for each of the Wild West Exodus factions?
Okay. I'll buy it. I'll give you a little teaser for each of them then. So name a faction and I'll give you a little teaser for it.
Redacted.
All right. I think that about does it, Stuart. I think we can let you go unless you had anything else, Brian. Did you have anything else to ask Stuart while we got him on the line?
No, I mean, he covered everything. I can just come up with more questions, but I don't want to keep them too long.
Yeah, I mean, you had a long weekend, Stuart, so we wanted to try and keep this short. And it was a very good weekend, I think, overall. And But we wanted to thank you for jumping on since you were over on this side of the world with us. So we, you know, figure it's a good opportunity to get you on in kind of our time zone, you know, as somebody's not. And we appreciate you coming on and talking a little bit about, you know, your big announcement at AdeptiCon with Lost World and, you know, just going in a little bit of what we can expect for Wild West Exodus also, Stuart.
Oh, no, it's no problem at all. It makes us doing what we do easier, or we can do things more confidently, knowing that it's obviously striking a chord with people, that hobbyists have got an interest in what we're doing, and it's gratifying because there's no reason why we should expect that kind of stuff. But yeah, obviously there is something about it that appeals, and not only that, you know, particularly for people that have been with Wild West Exodus for many years, prior to us taking over, it obviously we've taken things in a different direction, but it's still obviously something that's speaking to people, and that they're
it excites them. You know,
yeah.
I saw a lot of excitement this weekend.
Yeah, that's gratifying as well.
All right, we will go ahead and get out of here, Stuart, and let you go and get ready to make your trip back to the UK tomorrow. And like I said, we appreciate you being on, and thanks again.
No trouble. Pleasure as always, chaps. I'll no doubt speak to you again in the future.
Okay, we will talk to you later, Stuart. Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
All right, guys. Well, that about does all the content we have today for our anniversary birthday episode. But before we got out of here, we wanted to go over a couple things with you guys that is going on in the community, like new sets shipping. They actually should be shipping right now. So we have 4 new things coming out this month that you guys can go get your hands on. I noticed on Facebook Dark Council, some people have gotten them already and are already putting stuff together. And we did just have a little teaser leak today, right, Brian, of one of the posse cards from one of those sets, the Tainted Biology.
That is correct.
So if you guys missed it, check it out. You can dig for it. Let's go. Let me rewind a little bit. So the new sets we have are, we have the Tainted Biology, which is a new hex set. We have, oh boy, help me, Brian, help me. I'm going to screw it up. Bloody Espinosa.
Espinosa. It's the Espinosa.
I get it.
Yay!
I like Tom's version better.
Yeah, he covered up the journey.
And then we have legendary Dr. Carpathium, which basically is still the same model. I think they tweaked it a little bit just to clean up some of the details. And then we also have the Red Oak Bridge Terrain Set, which this set basically, you guys, what it is it will link the Red Oak Saloon with the Cat House. So you can have a little bridge going from one to the other to, you know.
It actually has two bridges.
Two bridges.
So there's a small bridge if you want the two buildings side by side.
Okay.
And so it's just like, it links the two upper deck balconies. But then there's a bigger bridge that actually comes up and over. So it is actually something you could do if you wanted to have them across the street from each other.
Oh.
You could have a bigger, longer bridge that goes over. So like a vehicle can actually drive under.
So it's kind of like those old crosswalks you see on the streets.
That's what I like.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like two ways you can link your two buildings. And it's actually kind of a neat idea that we could get two different options to link the two buildings. So, yeah, no, it's a neat little set.
It comes with lights, too, I think. Doesn't it come with, gas lights?
I believe so. I think it comes with a couple of gas lights that you can also decorate your street.
Yeah, I got to get online and put in my order, my pre-order, because I think it's still on pre-order right now.
It is. And so some of your retail stores, if they pre-ordered some of them have already started receiving these pre-order items, so they can start selling them, you know, tomorrow.
Yeah. And I think the cards are officially being released this weekend, which is, what, the 27th? I think is that they should be up on the site for the update.
Yeah, I think someone was talking to Warcradle today. It was Bytel. He was asking when he could see his cards.
I think I've seen a post from Clay every day of, you know, two more days, one more day.
Yeah. He's had his own little mini countdown. But they basically told him that it's soon. So it should be probably up tomorrow with the release of the things going from pre-order to, you know, live in the store.
Yeah.
I have a feeling we'll see them post up tomorrow.
Okay.
You know, I'm pretty sure that the Warcradle gang is just making sure there's no typos or glitches in any of the new cards. One thing he did say is there's some new special abilities in these two posses that are new to the game. So those are probably the reasons why we didn't see them early, is because they're making sure that those new mechanics are worded right.
Yeah, especially with a update coming soon, too. That's definitely going to include these. So
are not going to be 1.09. They will be 1.081. So obviously, we'll still have the ability to feedback these cards in case there is something that someone sees.
Yeah.
Like a typo or something that technically wise just doesn't make any sense. So someone could look at it and see it. And that way we get a little bit of ability to make a feedback before the 1.09.
Yep. And then on to, so they've been teasing us with next month's stuff already. And some of them I kind of have figured out. Other ones I don't have any clue. So,
right.
They shall be revealed soon.
Oh, no, we can talk about them a little
bit. You want to talk about them? You look like you're excited about them, so we'll talk about them. You look like you're excited about them, so we'll talk about them.
Well, at least the last one.
Okay, what's the last one?
The last tease was basically the spiked end of one of the chain weapons from the last two Coccaroli models that we've known about, because we saw their model early on before any of the Coccaroli were re-released. So it's the chain weapon guys that can like hit you with their chain and then drag you about with them. So there's a guy and a girl pair. And last year when we talked to Stuart, he said these two models were going to be in the Portal Vanguard posse. Now, all of these things that he teased us last summer about, subject to minor changes. So it's either going to be the Posse Vanguard posse for Nura for the Order, or they're releasing these two models like they released Orin and Zane. Okay. So
like don't know which pack, because yeah,
it's just a picture of one of the two chain weapons. So we're not sure which one it's going to be, but I can't wait until they confirm it. So,
so in about a week, Brian could be very happy. Well, all right. So you guys keep an eye open on all that new stuff coming. And like I said, that'll be pretty soon. As we're recording, we're just, about a week out from finding out what the next wave of pre-orders will be. So let's move into, I want to talk about AdeptiCon, give it a little bit of a wrap-up. That was at the beginning of this month. And AdeptiCon, overall, I would say went very, very well. One of the things that came out of AdeptiCon, so Warcradle and Stuart, they announced a new sister game. They released this news on the Thursday of AdeptiCon, Lost World Exodus. So this is going to be a new game in the world of the Dystopian Wars, and it has its own little story. It's going to have different mechanics, and actually, if you guys want to hear more about Lost World Exodus, me and Brian got together with Stuart at the end of AdeptiCon weekend, and we talked a little bit about the game and all the ins and outs, and you guys can find that in our sideshow, Ramblin'. It's episode 2, and that's in the feed with the rest of the Blackhoof Saloon episodes. Yeah, we kind of went in depth with Stuart about some of the mechanics and the just a little bit of how it works and some of the factions and stuff like that. to give you a little bit of a sneak peek in that. That's going to be pretty cool. So we're going to see a lot of new stuff in the same world, but a little bit different. It's going to give us a different look into the world that's the Dystopian Wars. So I'm excited about that. Also at AdeptiCon, so go over like the booth. So they had their, you know, their standard booth. It wasn't the huge one. It was their basic booth with three tables for demos. And the demo tables were constantly full. So a lot of people would go and do demos in like just little groups and then go buy posses after posses. And Warcradle actually sold out of posses on the first day. I actually managed to pick up the new Warrior Nation posse. I think I got the second to the last one they had there. So the two new posses flew off the shelf.
So what did they do for the rest of the weekend then?
Well, they had a lot of the other stock, like, so, you know, the previous releases. It's just those brand new ones were the ones that sold out really fast.
Because,
you know, those ones, I think those ones were, this was right before they started shipping those out, actually, too. So if you were at the con, you could manage to pick up those new ones. That one, and it was the Edison one, and then they had the Wolves and the Spirit Walkers. You know, they had all the add-ons that you would want for those posses.
Right.
And then, of course, they had the, you know, the exclusive model, which was a kind of a sneak peek into Lost World Exodus, which is the new con exclusive. And it's not available in the store right now unless it is actually during a convention. They make it available in the store that you can order it. Or if you're at a show, you can buy it. And what's neat...
What's this model's name?
Oh, don't even. Don't even. I know it's a Polish-sounding name, so...
Say it. Say it.
No way.
The first name's easy. It's Jedzia.
Okay, Jedzia. I can do that. The last,
the
one?
Last name is tricky. It's Pasiskio.
I know there is a pronunciation for it.
Kosciuszko.
We probably have it somewhere. But yeah, so that is the new exclusive model, and she's on a tread bike, which is just, it's awesome looking. It's really awesome looking. And the neat thing about this is it's our first peek into Lost World Exodus, how some of the models will play in both Lost World Exodus and Wild West Exodus. So this model actually has an outlaw card that you can go in the outlaw section and find it. And, you know, she's a mercenary, so you can put her in, you know, the outlaw posses. And she's just nasty looking at her stats. So she's going to be fun to play with. I'm already trying to decide who to swap out for her just to try her out. But so that was the booth. It was packed. A lot of people were buying in. They were selling out of a lot of stuff. They were constantly just filled up all weekend with people either just discovering the game or checking them out. A lot of people were giving the Dystopian Wars playtest. Parker was running people through that. And at one point, it was kind of neat to see there were some old school players at Dystopian Wars. You know, and they came by to check it out, and they're kind of like, I don't know. And, you know, after about 5 minutes talking to Chris Pond, they were like, oh, yeah, this is the game. They, you know, a lot of people came away from the table with positive expectations for when the game comes out and are really looking forward to that. So that was the booth. And then on Saturday, they had the Gunslinger tournament. I'm trying to think how many people there were. There was, I want to say, 16 people, minus Tom.
Shut up.
Sorry, Tom. I couldn't resist it. But actually, so the tournament overall, the atmosphere was a lot of excitement. All the games I had, and from what I could see, everybody was having fun. There was a lot of, you know, it didn't feel like a tournament. It didn't feel like I got to win. It felt like, let's get together, have some fun and play games. And it was a lot of fun. I didn't fare as well as I would have liked. Sometimes the dice were very wishy-washy. I did win. Well, I can't say I won all my games. Technically, I won two of the games. We played like three rounds, and the other one I tied. And I made mistakes. You know, that's the thing about if anybody is kind of hesitant about doing a tournament, let me tell you, it's the best way to learn the game. Because if you do make mistakes, you are going to remember those mistakes. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. You know, they put on a real good tournament for all the community members. So if you guys get an opportunity to play in a tournament, do, because it's a lot of fun. And they had the tables just filled up with all the red oak buildings, so that was a lot of fun. And then Saturday night, so in our last episode, I got on here with some of my local players in the Chicagoland area. We put on a free event for the community members that were there, and we did what we were calling WW Drinksitis event, in which we came up with a scenario that involved Old Man Jenkins and his moonshine still, and you got drink tokens that broke the rules of all the games. And I actually still have yet to put up the scenario, but you know what? I think after talking about it now on the show, I'm going to have to put it up. Everybody that came out to that Saturday night had a lot of fun with it. And yeah, it was very positive feedback overall community through the whole weekend. And if you guys get the chance to attend a con where they're doing events and stuff, definitely go to it. The community is really, really good for our game. Got to meet a lot of listeners, which was cool to meet them face to face. Like Tom, we were talking about how at PAX, you know, you had somebody come up to you and just say, "Hey, Tom," and, you know, you didn't know who these people were, but they knew who you were just based on your voice. I had that happen in the tournament. So I got paired up with a player. It was Neil, who is Neil. He's up in like the Minnesota area. Yeah, he's in the Minnesota area.
Oh, yeah, Neil.
And I was, you know, we just started chatting. He goes, "Wait a minute." He's like, you know, somebody said my name, and he asked, "Oh, from?" And I was like, "Yeah." And he's like, "Oh, okay." He's like, "I thought I recognized the voice." And it was just, it was weird that people know us just by our voices. And I'm like, "Oh, right. Boy, I got to talk proper now."
Well, you know, they'll be able to recognize you by your inability to pronounce things.
Well, that's for sure. That's for sure. I'm sure I did plenty of that. But yeah, so we got to meet a bunch of the community members that we've met before. Like, so we, you know, I got to see Jan. We got to see Mike again, Parker. I met some guys I never met before, like Benji. It was the first time I met him, Neil, Ian. Dingo was there again with his buddy Anthony, which it was always fun to see them. They were doing a bunch of open play. But yeah, I mean, it's not much more to say other than that it was a really good weekend. I was glad to meet a lot of people and chat and, you know, just talk about Wild West Exodus. Of course, like many conventions, there's never enough time. We wanted to do more open play, but, you know, it's just, it's so crazy at conventions. And this was a typical crazy convention. So that was AdeptiCon 2019, and it was a lot of fun. And I actually, while I was there, I did get to talk to a couple of people. So I will go ahead and put these little interview bits in here, and you guys can take a listen. All right, guys, this is Eric with Blackhoof Saloon, and I am here with Chris Pond at AdeptiCon. Chris, how's AdeptiCon going? What do you guys think overall of AdeptiCon?
Well, this is my first AdeptiCon, and I wasn't really sure what to expect. I knew it was really heavily miniatures-based and wargaming rather than something like Gen Con, which is, I mean, it's every game, isn't it, Gen Con?
Yeah.
But it's at the moment dominated by board games because, you know, that's what's hot right now. So yeah, this is a real breath of fresh air just to see everybody really focused on miniature gaming. You know, the retail area, the kind of the exhibitor area is quite small compared to the gaming hall. And actually, It's not just about buying stuff, it's actually about coming and playing games, which is great. And we've had a real, we've been jam-packed on demo tables.
You guys
for
have actually
whole...
run out of stuff.
We're running out some of the stock, the sales have been amazing. People are really getting involved in playing the games, and you know, we've yet to even have the busiest day, which is tomorrow.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Once that hits, I'm going to be running the tournament, so I'm fine. I've got an easy day tomorrow, but you know, the rest of the guys are going to be right up against it, I think, which is great.
Okay. I have a quick question for you.
Sure.
So since I got you on the show, I always got to ask people some goofy questions. So. Question about hats. Are you a Stetson guy or a 10-gallon guy?
I can't wear hats.
I can't wear a hat.
No hat looks good on me. Whether it's a baseball cap, nothing. It's horrible.
Maybe then you go
with the 10-gallon, you know, it's got to be, if I'm going to wear one, it's got to be a big one.
All right, cool. So, all right, well, thank you, Chris. Hopefully you guys have a rest of the weekend's really good, and I'll see you in the tournament. Expecting it to be a lot of fun.
I'm expecting you to win.
I don't know about that. Thanks, Chris.
Cheers, Eric.
All right, I grabbed Daz at the Warcradle booth. Daz, this is like, what, your third time here at AdeptiCon?
I'd say it's my second. As the second time I was here, I was in my hotel room after a car crash, so I didn't get to see much of AdeptiCon.
Well, let's keep our fingers crossed.
I suppose, timeline, this is my third, yes.
Okay. It's hard for me to ask you, what do you think of AdeptiCon, but what do you think of it this year so far? It's a little bit bigger this year.
I love it. Absolutely love it. For me, it's more about getting to meet people.
Yeah.
So I love meeting people that you get to see online and you get those chats going, but meeting people in person is a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
And this one's been really special because obviously Exodus has built and built and built over the years. So this one, we're seeing old friends come back, but I think the amount of new players we've had has outweighed anything that we've done before. So this has been awesome.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of groups of guys, you know, whether in clubs or, you know, they're from another state and they just come together, really jumping into the game. I've seen a lot of people walking away with handfuls of boxes.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it's day two and we've started selling out of stuff.
Yeah.
And that's pretty cool.
That's not a bad problem.
It's not a bad problem. But while I think about it, another reason I'm enjoying this is the first year that I've been here as our official studio painter. So that's been really humbling. So a lot of people have been commenting on my work, which I always think is substandard anyway.
Have you been given tips out then?
Oh, dude. What I love the most is just, you know, cracking the egg open for people. So what they think is something really difficult to do, it's not. And just show them a few tips, even just a few pointers, they're going to go home and be able to replicate that. So, for me, being a studio painter, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But helping everybody else get better, that's what it's all about for me.
And you're still kind of overseeing the demo tables here this weekend.
That's been hard, dude. Yeah. That's been really,
You've been wanting to jump in there, haven't you?
I have. But once again, this is the first year for me where I've seen the spirit of what the War Host is really all about. And I've had to give up my kind of throne. You know, I'm king of the dancing monkeys, but it's been nice to let other people kind of do that.
Yeah.
Like I said, it's been difficult. I've wanted to dive in, but it's not that the guys are doing anything wrong. It's the fact that it's, you know, sometimes you've got to let the kids, free and let them do what they do. So that's been difficult, but, the guys here have been fantastic.
All right. Very good. Very good. Thank you, Daz.
Not a problem, buddy. Anytime.
Okay, I'm here with Parker from the Battle Hammer at the Warcradle booth, who's doing Dystopian War demos today. How's that going, Parker?
Ahoy, hoy! It's going very well. I'm actually finding it very easy to run demos for this because once people get a hold of the rules, they pretty much just know how to play.
Okay.
There's very little in the way of special rules for this and special rules for that.
Okay.
A lot of stuff's on cards, I've got custom dice, so it just makes things a little bit easier for me, which is nice, you know? I always find when I'm running for Wireless Exodus, I always forget to tell them that really important rule, and it just completely slips my mind.
I do the same thing, too.
Yeah.
I do that when I'm playing. So overall, AdeptiCon, this is your first AdeptiCon. What do you think of it? Compared to Gen Con?
I actually think I like it more. Gen Con is so big.
Yeah.
Like, you just can't get around it in time. You can't see everything. there's so much to see. Like, you don't really want to have a demo of a game because there's always something else around the corner.
Yeah.
Whereas for this, I think even as running demos, I feel like I can go over there and do some shopping. I can go over there and check a game out. You know, I've found that if people want demos, they don't mind playing for a little while. I found at Gen Con, sometimes I'd be like, do you want to get a demo? It's like, no, I've got too much to do. I can't have a demo.
Yeah.
I'm only here for a day and then I'm off. Whereas here, everyone seems a bit more relaxed. And also, everyone's miniature gamers. You don't come across people who go, oh, what's this? Are you rolling dice for a thing? Yeah, it's not a board game. It's not a role-playing game. It's not a jigsaw puzzle thing. It's a miniatures game, and everyone knows what that means, which is makes things a lot easier for me and obviously the rest of the crew.
Yeah, yeah. So have you walked around any of the actual tournaments and stuff and looked at everything?
I've had a little scan. I think hopefully tomorrow, next day, I'm going to have a proper walk up and down the aisles because the tables look great.
Yeah.
We had a tournament in the UK a little while ago for 40K. It was one of the nationals or something. And they just had polystyrene blocks of terrain everywhere. But here, like, all the tables seem to have a lot of work put into them.
Yeah.
There's a bolt action table with like a proper cornfield and individual corn stalks and stuff. It looks amazing, which is really great. Great to see.
Okay.
And I've met probably 90% of my internet nerds that I really wanted to meet. Obviously yourself, people, painters who I follow online, like Kenny Boucher and Vince Venturella. The only Mel the Terrain Shooter I saw, got to shake his hand. Sam Lenz and people like that. I'm just after Scott the Miniature Maniac, and I'll have my full internet, like, YouTube list done. Because it's a bit smaller, you actually do see people,
you get to
rather
see
than
people.
Gen Con's just like,
Yeah, you can lose yourself in there.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing, and it's not a bad thing. I mean, for people at home in the UK who might be listening to this, the main hall for AdeptiCon is about the same size as Salute, which is like one of the biggest things in the UK. But they don't have all the tournament tables. And it's not 4 days long.
Yeah.
So you just walk around once, buy all your stuff and go.
You're done.
Yeah.
All right.
But
well,
this is awesome.
Thank you, Parker.
Thank you.
We'll see you a little bit later today.
Yeah, baby.
Throughout the week. And this is only day two. We still got two more.
It's only day two and I already am in pain just below the knees.
All right, guys. I'm here with community member Benji, and we just finished up the tournament and our open play, and I wanted to ask Benji what he thought about AdeptiCon overall and kind of the community, how he sees everything went this weekend.
It was incredible. Lots of good vibes, lots of great discussions, and lots of great games. We really had a solid turnout for both events.
Yeah, we had a fantastic turnout.
And a fantastic amount of each faction. We didn't miss a faction. We weren't overpowered by one faction, which made it really nice, which allowed us to not face that one faction all day.
Well, it shows really how even the game is, you know, how fantastic the game's balanced. And, I mean, there are still some things, you know, that we can work on. Yeah, but, I mean, it's very balanced game. It's a fun game.
Yeah, it's even more. It's, your list is yours. You want your flavor. There's even one player who ran a similar list to me, and he had a couple of named characters, and, you know, everything I've been talked about, you know, it was different enough that he had his own experience, so it was really nice that way.
Yeah, yeah. And what do you think of community overall? We got a good community.
You know, what I'm going to say about the community is it's growing, it's embracing, it's very, we want to play games, we want to have fun, we want to share ideas, so that was fantastic. Everybody wants to be happy.
It's a very passionate community. Yeah,
absolutely. And, you know, short amount of time, you know, we had together, lots of great friendships were made. Yes. Even drove down here to find a guy who lives within 20 miles of myself.
Yeah, so. That's crazy. I forgot. Yeah, you met a player that's local to you.
Yeah. So even talking to the guys at the booth, I mean, everything is good. You know, not to say everything is awesome. You know, because the song's going to get in everyone's head, but it's really solid to see a lot of great people playing a great game.
Definitely, definitely. Okay, one last question for you, Benji, before you go, because I have yet to ask you this. Are you a Stetson or 10-gallon?
Stetson.
Stetson. All right, there we go. We got another Stetson guy. Thank you, Benji, for giving us your little bit of input on the AdeptiCon. I'm glad you had some fun this weekend.
Yeah, thank you for running that open event, and it was nice to have the competitive and the fun. It was very fun.
Definitely, definitely. I think there's going to be more to come. So
absolutely.
All right. Thanks, guys.
All right. In other little tidbits to mention, so Brian had a guest appearance. Brian's going worldwide, and he appeared on a...
I don't know if it's worldwide. Well, I mean, it's still here in America.
He appeared on another podcast, Third Floor Wars podcast, and this podcast, the host Craig basically has guests on there, and they tell him why he should be playing a certain game. So Brian was a guest on that and was telling Craig why he should be playing Wild West Exodus. And you were also on there with Paul from Three Men in a War Game. And do you guys think you convinced Craig into playing Wild West Exodus? Because I know you mentioned a certain posse, and he about lost his lid.
So the way that that podcast, definitely go take a listen to it, is actually pretty funny. Where me and Paul are basically tag teaming different questions that go over, you know, aspects of the game. At one point we're in a gap, you know, so, and he separated the questions with time gaps, so for editing purposes. And in one of the gaps, we just happened to be chatting again while he's setting up for the next section. And it's not recording at this point. And I mentioned the Wayward Eight, and Paul kind of said, "Oh yeah, because that's that after the Firefly crew." And and Craig like, "Wait, what?" He's like, "What? There's a Firefly crew?" And then Paul's like, "Oh yeah, they're awesome." He goes, "Well, you should have led with that." That'd get me in a game. So he goes, "Okay, well, that wasn't recorded. You're going to have to redo this conversation." We actually had to redo that whole intro of the Wayward Eight because he was like, "There's a what?"
I think that posse right there gets a lot of people into the game.
Right.
I will admit, Brian, so when I listened to it, it was like... same old Brian, listen to same old Brian, and, you know, you going on and on. But it felt weird. I was like, wait a second, that's our Brian. What's he over there for?
Right. Okay, so the hardest part was, because it was such a taking turns kind of thing, and, you know, those of the listeners of our podcast, we kind of talk over each other. So there was a lot of things unsaid. That I'm like, I needed to say, but didn't have the time, and he moved on. Especially when we're talking about fluff.
No, man, you're the guest. You talk over them. That's just the way it works.
Right.
You do it your way.
See, I just can edit and delete you guys. No, I don't do that. But, yeah, so if you guys want to give a listen, especially if you guys are kind of on the fence about playing Wild West Exodus, it's a good show that maybe if you guys listen to it, you'll see why, you know, so many of us just love the game. But check that out.
Wait a minute. If someone's on the fence about playing Wild West Exodus,
oh boy,
why are they listening to us? I'm just saying.
Wow. One episode. He's
on the fence. If you have a friend who's on the fence, have him give a list.
Yes.
That better, Donald.
I feel better now. Thank you.
All right. So I didn't mention earlier the other big thing that we have, and I know you guys have probably been waiting for it, and we've been plugging it for episodes now. We had a contest. And we wanted to end this contest on our anniversary episode. And the contest, we were giving away a saloon, a Red Oak Saloon. And the contest was to submit a story, a short story, you know, have the saloon in it. And then we also had the rules of working our tropes into it. And the tropes, so a lot of people weren't sure where to find those. And the... like I mentioned earlier in the show, every episode I put in some of our outtakes that I cut out of the show because they're just us losing it. And I this was one particular outtake from our very first episode where we mentioned the tropes of a saloon. And we more or less, each one of us claimed one of them. And I'm sorry, Tom, but you kind of asked for the trope of the madame of the saloon, even though you didn't say madame.
Well, you know, here's the thing. Through all these stories, everyone just sort of ran with the same idea there. You know, the madame just being the person who runs the girls, right? You know, could have been anything. It's kind of like the pimp, you know? But no, apparently in every story, I'm a transvestite. And
nothing wrong with that.
Well, no.
Okay, I'm okay with that. It was actually pretty funny, but I was like, damn, not a single one do I get to play the pimp hand.
He wanted to be Superfly. That's what it was.
I totally did, or at least Huggy Bear. Jeez.
So yeah, we had many entries, which were all great. We really loved lots of the bits and pieces, and you know how you guys were creative. Do you guys want to discuss our winner a little bit, or should we just announce who the winner is? I mean, we had long discussions of these before we actually started recording, so.
We did. I'm like, what do we want to discuss?
I mean, I had a hard time picking just one. I had it narrowed down, and until the three of us actually got together and started talking about them, did I actually make up my mind? And like I said, they're all very creative, and we loved them. I think you guys did a great job. I'd love to see some of these continued. You know, we actually said that whoever the winner was, we were going to read and do something special with. So
right. So the funniest thing is, as we were talking, it was like we kind of evolved to the winner. And we literally, all three of us at the same time, was like, I could totally read this as a novel. Like this story was like a prologue to a larger story.
Yes.
And we all three were like, yeah, I'm left at the end of this short story wanting to know where it goes from there. And that's basically what secured him number one. I mean, he followed the rules. He has us in tropes. I also thought it was one of the cleverer ways of introducing us. Each of us, we each had our own moment in the story, and it was actually, I thought, well, we're all implemented. You know, it was cute. The dialogue was really good. It was just overall a really good story. Not to take away from the other, because I liked all of them, but we still have to pick a winner.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we really had to start nitpicking at them a little bit to be like, well,
it was hard. You know, it was so, you know, hard to pick one.
You have to get down to one. So, you know, like you said, I think the dialogue was a big part of that. I think the dialogue on this one was pretty well written. It hit everything. The pacing was pretty good. So I'm looking forward to us doing what we do with it. We've had some discussions on how to on presentation, but
Tom wants to do a robot chicken video.
Come on, I think that'll work the best for it. That'll be awesome.
So Brian, let's do it. Brian, who was the winner? Name the winner. They're probably dying.
Okay, did he put a title on that on his story? Oh. Let me check.
I don't think there was a title on it. There was no title. It was just, here's my story.
Okay, so there's no title. So I'm gonna title it The Morning After.
I don't know about that. That sounds like a pill.
Sounds like a pill.
No, okay. So there's not a title.
Yeah,
he didn't label it. Now, mind you, he can come up with one later if he wants, or if he comes up with something better.
The title is when he writes the rest of the novel that this prologue goes with.
That's true. This title is prologue.
Yeah. So, you know, just out on this story we discuss is that, for winning this award, this author is going to have to go and write the novel now to continue the story and develop it further.
Right. So the author of this, I mean, really a really well written short story. His name is Benji.
Yay, Benji!
His last name is, I'm going to let Eric pronounce.
It's Grosek. He told me I was saying it right last time, so.
Oh, okay.
unless I screwed it up and I don't know, but he'll let me know. Saying, I know that for sure.
Is that the same you said last time? I don't know.
I think so.
Right. So Benji's story basically is an intro story. It's a good short story because it talks about the characters. It kind of intros. There's good characterization, but it leaves the story untold, but tells the story.
Yeah, it makes you want more, you know what I mean? Basically.
Right. It is perfect short story with a hook at the end that you're interested in.
Yeah, it tells a little bit of a backstory from the perspective of someone being told what happened to them the night before. Oh,
right.
You know, and so by doing that, it starts, you know, going into all the different characters and what's going on within this story. And really the story, like we said, ends up really being what seems like a prologue to what would be a novel, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, my favorite part, like you mentioned, we've mentioned before, is the dialogue. The dialogue really, I thought, fit the characters in the story. It really kind of shed light on who that character was and, you know, basically how they acted and, you know, just the dialogue captured the characteristics of that character, I thought, very well.
Oh, yeah. Well, and especially since the characters in this story, the main characters of the story, have been in novels already in the Wild West Exodus fluff. So it was actually really well drafted. You capture the personality of the characters who are larger in life. I mean, we've already talked about the posse that the story's characters are from, but it's just really well done. So, you know, golf clap to Benji. Yeah. It was really good. You've got three fans of your writing piece. I'm sure you'll get many more after we, put your story out there. Yeah. And see where.
So what we want to do is we're going to go ahead and post up Benji's short story on the Facebook page. And like we said before, we're going to brainstorm and do something on the side, like a side extra bonus type thing. We're going to find some people that can read well, possibly not me, and do something with it and add some sound effects
you're
and all that.
You're going to read Jake.
Okay, I can handle that.
Come on, Eric. You read very well. You just don't enunciate.
I don't enunciate.
Or pronunciate.
Well,
either or. One is saying it right and the other one's saying it clear.
That's because I'm too much of a hick. But anyway, congratulations, Benji. You did a great job. We will get in touch with you and get your address and all that type of stuff, and we can send you out a brand new Red Oak Saloon for your games and tabletop. I mean, I saw that you're probably going to need it. You're starting to run events up by you, and yeah, congratulations.
And just because the box says Red Oak Saloon, you know it's really the black Hoof Saloon.
That's right. And we want to see pictures when it's built, Benji. So,
Brian, what are you doing?
Cleaning my cell phone case. Gross.
That's a different look for him. He's not working on models.
Yeah, he's just like blowing on a case. He's like, ha ha.
I would give Benji a yeehaw, but I don't think I can do a good yeehaw.
Do a good yeehaw.
I'm more of a yip
Brian,
yip guy.
Brian, give us a yeehaw.
Yeehaw!
There you go. There's
that
one for you, Benji.
I like that one.
That was a good one.
Thanks.
All right, guys. Why don't you say we wrap up the show and get out of here. Episode 12 is done. I think we filled the show up with a lot of stuff for people to listen to. Just a reminder, you guys can check us out on all the different interweb sites like Facebook. Go out to our Facebook page. You can send us an email at the Gmail. We're also on Instagram and Twitter, and you can also find us on our YouTube channel where you can actually watch, listen to the episodes there, and we have some other videos too from the different conventions and stuff like that that you can check out. Feel free, like I said, send us an email with any ideas for future shows or, you know, discussion topics or questions. We can throw questions in a hat and have a segment where we just pick some random questions. So
don't be recalcitrant. Just send those right in.
So thank you guys for listening to us for 12 episodes throughout the last year. And we also want to give a shout out thank you to all the special guests we had on the different episodes, like Max, Stuart. We had some of the local players to meet, Chris and Sean. And thank you guys for listening and making us want to keep doing it. So this is Eric. Take it easy.
See you on the trails, boy.
Good night.
And remember to always ride with the sun at your back and always roll those big crits, guys. We will talk to you later. Thanks, guys. I was waiting for you to start singing happy birthday again, Tom.
Which one? Do you want like a regular happy birthday or like a Marilyn Monroe happy birthday?
I don't know if I want a Marilyn Monroe. That might just enforce the idea of you cross-dressing.
To you, happy birthday. To you, happy birthday, Blackhoof Saloon. Happy birthday to you.
I hope you did.
Yeah. There, I got a good outtake right there for the end of the show.
Yeah, you do.
All right.
Thanks for stopping by the Blackhoof Saloon, y'all. We hope you enjoyed your visit. Feel free to get a hold of us with comments or questions via the interweb and shoot us a telegraph at blackhoofsaloon@gmail.com or find us on the Facebook at Blackhoof WWX Podcast. Music provided for use by Ross Bugden and can be found at one of his YouTube channels, Ross Bugden Music or Ross Bugden Composer. Until your next visit, ride with the sun at your back, and always roll those crits.
Well, Brian, you think we could do something with all this?
Yeah, we can do it.
All right.
And if we can't, we can't. But let's see what we get.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and try. Maybe we can get something decent out. All right. So
Tom proved he can bullshit. Let's go.
Thanks. That's just so good.
Is that our first outtake?
I wanted him for his lasso, actually, more than anything else, because I'm using a judgment. I could use Jed to pull guys in towards the judgment. So kind of range him out in front a little bit.
Yeah.
And then the judgment uses its own to pull guys in and then just kill them.
Incarcerate.
Yes, incarcerate. Kill him.
That was with the wayward eight, and they were kind of...
And the guy wakes up drunk as Cooter Brown, and the rest of the team are teasing him about what he got into the night before.
Yeah, he was hitting on you, Tom.
Yeah, no.
I just thought it was a clever way of, you know, talking about the bar, talking about each one of us.
It's now 106 pages.
Funny side story. So I'm getting us off the rails here, actually. I was looking on Green Stuff's website at like different basing type stuff, and they had little resin things you could get to add to the base. Guess what I saw in there, Brian? I saw books. I saw big books for that Tom miniature.
Oh, man. Nice.
I'm going to take one of my extra figures. I'm going to make a Tom Wild West model yet. Anyway, okay, I got us off the rail.
You know what? They're going to have to make a Blackhoof Saloon posse.
We just have one of the models sitting at the piano.
Yep, someone's just sitting on the piano. You have like a he/she like leaning on a railing,
what, crooked wig,
shaving at a mirror. Oh,
that would be awesome, the bearded lady.
Oh God. Oh. Well, what was it? Was it Benji? So his version of you in there, yes, you were cross-dressing, but you were undercover. So you were like Kevin Kline in Wild Wild West.
Yeah, that's why I liked it, because it wasn't just straight up, he likes to wear dresses. It was like he was undercover.
No, and that's kind of funny. I liked that a lot, because we talked about that at one point, Brian, because we were joking around about that. Way back when you first got the Jed thing, I was like, "Oh man, I want to be your hired goon sidekick." and then that happened, and I was like, "Oh man, just have him like running along, like ripping off the dress, trying to back you up."
I'm coming, Dad. I'm coming.
I'm coming. Damn it! I can't run in this skirt. Doing it.
Yeah.
So we're basically going to do a robot chicken thing.
Oh, absolutely. I think that's the way to do this.
Oh, God. Wow.
Yes, I'm in. I'm all in on that.
All right, you know what? I'm going to circle it. Benji's.
Circle it. Benji, you won. We're making a robot chicken out of your story.
Hey, Tom, since we're not really talking show, I need you to say, what's the word that everybody uses on Facebook to cover up something that's secret? Redacted?
Redacted?
Yeah, I need you to say that a couple times and give me a machine gun redacted.
Redacted? Redacted? Redacted, 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 cool. And redacted. Redact this. Redact that. You're redacted.
I think that will work.
Okay.
He just opened up, and
so went... you should start off with a disclaimer. Be like, you know, because Brian is so pushy in trying to get his information out of Stuart, and Stuart is not a recalcitrant chap. We've had to redact much of this interview.
You know what? I think I'm going to actually take that little bit at the end and put it in there where I cut. It still amazes me when I get messages like that are like from there, or, you know, we've gotten them from Australia, and I'm just like, holy, somebody from across the world is listening to us babble.
Right.
Great. So now the whole world knows what an idiot I am. That's fantastic.
I was teasing Mary at AdeptiCon. She was giving me, oh, all these people are going to be talking to you, blah, 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 fans. And at the end of the weekend, I told her, I was like, yeah, I gave some autographs. She's like, what? Shut up. I said, yeah, I signed somebody's chest. They're going to get it tattooed.
That's awesome.